Hi everyone, happy Monday. Great to have you along today. It's a beautiful day here. It's really been nice lately. It's been in the 70s and 80s, absolutely gorgeous. Perfect time to be outside before the weather gets too terribly hot. So welcome to our live stream today. It's gonna be a good one today. We're gonna be talking about my summer vegetable garden fertilizing routine. It's super important to have a fertilizing routine for your garden. And I know it's a lot of, it's a topic that a lot of people just kind of aren't sure about, or maybe don't do enough and then wonder why your garden isn't productive. So we'll get into that in just a moment. But I wanna thank you guys for hanging out with me here today. And let's say hello to those of you here in the chat. I see Jay Tony is here. Joyce Fulgham here from Virginia. Martha Shaw, welcome. Red Cup 1011. Cliff and Nisha, our moderators, are here. John Ward is here, good afternoon. Rocky USA. Let me scroll back up through here. Miriam Pauls, great to have you here. My plants are finally in the ground, and I bet that just feels so, so good. And I know that Cliff and Nisha actually too. Cliff is in Idaho and has had, what, a freeze last night, I think 29 degrees. And I know Nisha, I saw on her Instagram last week, had snow in Colorado. Now, I grew up in Colorado, and I know a lot of times in April or May, we can get very heavy, wet snows. I think you just got a little bit of a dusting, Nisha. But you still have to really pay attention to the weather because a lot of people aren't quite past their last frost day yet. And Mel, thank you so much. Says, happy anniversary, Camera Guy and Callie Kim. Today is our 35th wedding anniversary. I cannot believe it. It's crazy. It just seems like yesterday. Now I know I'm starting to sound old when I say that, but it does seem like yesterday. And I was saying in the chat earlier, every year gets better. You know, after being married for 35 years, you kind of learn not to sweat the small stuff because it's just not worth it. There's so many more things that are much more important than worrying about the tiny little things that used to bug us when we were a whole lot younger. So yeah, so it's great. We're actually gonna go out tomorrow night to celebrate. Mondays are usually so busy for me with the live stream. We usually have tons of weekend orders to fill on Mondays. And today is just you know, a super busy day. So tomorrow we'll get to go out in the evening and relax and have a good time. So thank you so much, you guys. Liz, it's great to see you on here. I always love seeing Liz on, but welcome. So let's jump into things here, okay, you guys? Whoops, I just dropped my pen. We have got a lot to cover today. And before I forget, there's no live stream next Monday on Memorial Day. So take the day off, enjoy the time with your family. We're probably gonna hang around here and have a barbecue, have some people over. So enjoy the time off and we'll be back the following Monday. Can't remember the date. It's the first Monday in June, so make sure you join us back then. Okay, so it's so important to have a regular fertilizing routine for your summer garden, especially, but for your garden anytime if you grow year round. And the reason for that is, I mean, just like our bodies get depleted, we can't go for like forever on just one meal, our garden does the same thing. So if you want to keep your garden continually producing and really pumping out the harvest all summer long, the best thing you can do for it is really develop a real regular feeding regimen, fertilizing routine. We're talking organic nutrients here. All the fertilizers I use on my garden are organic, but I really want to encourage you to keep it simple, okay? You don't have to run out and buy every single fertilizer on the market. There's so many out there that are marketed for tomatoes, for citrus, for strawberries, for all different kinds of things. So I'll share my go-to products in just a moment, but keep it simple and really do develop a good routine. Now, a lot of people get confused when we talk about NPK. Those are just the nutrients that you'll see on fertilizer bottles that your plant really needs the most. So here's a bottle of fish fertilizer, which is actually one of my go-tos as well. The first number that you see, the 5 here, refers to the nitrogen or the N. And nitrogen basically is the nutrient that provides the green leafy growth to your plants, all the green foliage. That's what nitrogen does. The second number here, and this is just a real quick overview, it's not every single little detail, but just so you kind of know what those basic nutrients do. The second one is, I always get these two mixed up, is phosphorus. Yeah, phosphorus. And what that does is really help your plant in flowering and fruiting. So that's what the phosphorus does, the P. The third nutrient there is the K, that refers to the potassium, and that really helps the general overall health of your plants. So that's what the K refers to. So when you look at a bag or a bottle of fertilizer, you're going to see those three numbers, and that's basically what that means. Just so you know and aren't confused, when I'm talking about NPK, that's just the basics. Now, everything I'm talking about today is all written down for you in much more detail in my book, The Raised Bed Gardener, or First Time Gardener, Raised Bed Gardening. So if you want more detail, I have a whole section on my fertilizing routine, including more details on NPK and all the different basic fertilizers that I use, as well as my routine that I use. So basically, I boil down fertilizers into two different categories: the slow release and the water soluble. And the ingredients in the water soluble are immediately available to your plants. And I like to use both because I want to feed my plants over the season, and I also want to give them a quick boost, like right when I get them planted, so they really take off. So the general lowdown on the time release fertilizer that I use two, actually three. The first one, and one of my favorites, I'm gonna pull this out here, is compost. Now, I've got some compost fresh made here in my own backyard, and you guys have seen me use compost in many, many of my videos, including the one we did on Saturday on beans. I love to put compost at the base of my plants. It just smells so good, it smells so earthy, and it's a really great way to feed your plants for free if you make it yourself. And compost has a super low NPK, but it's one of the best things that you can use on your plants. So if you haven't started composting, highly recommend it. I've got a whole compost playlist. You can compost in a small space, like a 5-gallon bucket. You can compost in a huge compost sack. I love the Smart Pots compost sack. It's 100 gallons, or you can use like a tumbler, or you can just use a freestanding pile. So there's all kinds of different ways that you can make your own compost, no matter how much space you have. And it's really not as hard as you think. So that's pretty much my go-to as far as the slow release. The other one that I love to use, and I've used this for years, are worm castings. These are the Vermistera worm castings. And worm castings is basically, in case you didn't know, worm poop. So let me just hold a handful up here. I'm going to spill it all over myself. But it's basically worm poop. We all know how great worms are for the garden. And this is a great slow-release fertilizer, very low in NPK, but does help your plants be healthy. It's got tons of beneficial bacteria and microbes. Besides the fact that when you add worm castings to your soil, there are teeny tiny little worm eggs in here. So over time, you have to use less because the worm eggs hatch. You'll find tons of worms in your garden, and then they'll deposit their own worm castings over time. So this is very powerful. I love this stuff. Now, the other one that I use too, and I actually forgot to bring this down with me, is an organic granular fertilizer. And I'm not really partial to a specific brand. You can get, I've got worm castings all over me now. You can just get a bag that you find at your local garden center. You know, I prefer to use organic, and I like to keep it kind of balanced around a 5, 3, 4 NPK or somewhere around there. But don't get too caught up in the numbers. Just get yourself a good balanced organic fertilizer. And those three things are what I use for my slow release. Now, my quick release, really what quick release or water soluble does, you add it to water. Usually it's concentrated, you add it to water, and then it gives your plant an immediate boost. So my go-tos are the Vermistera Vitality or the Vermistera Worm Tea. This stuff works great. Again, I've used it in my garden for, gosh, I wanna say 5 or 7 years. This one I've used for just a couple of years, but it really does the job. It has a natural growth hormone. And again, it comes from worm castings from worms. So you really can't go wrong with this. And then another one of my favorites is this fish fertilizer. This is very, very reasonable. You can grab it at most garden centers or on Amazon. And this has a 5-1-1, so it's a little bit higher in nitrogen, which is great. We'll talk about that in just a moment. This is very low in NPK, as well as the worm tea. Vermistera worm tea is low in NPK as well. And then I also use, I forgot to bring a bottle down with me, the Good Dirt Plant Food. I love that one too, because it's very convenient to apply. Besides being a great fertilizer and a little bit higher in nitrogen, is because it has a hose end sprayer on it, so you can just attach it to your hose, and it just makes very, very quick work out of fertilizing your garden. And I have links to everything in the video description along with some discount codes for some of those as well. So yeah, fish fertilizer, Nana Blue is everywhere. And that's one of the things that's great about it is it's readily available to everyone. And I wanna say this, gosh, I don't know. I know the prices have gone up, but I think it's under $10 a bottle. It used to be $5 a bottle, but I think it's gone up a little bit since then. So it's very inexpensive and really does wonders. Okay, so that's just kind of the lowdown. First off, the basics on the types of fertilizers that I prefer. Again, keeping it simple. I don't buy every single fertilizer for every different type of plant out there. There's no need to do that. They're all basically the same. $10.99. Okay, thank you so much. Just really keep things simple and do it to whatever budget you have. So this is super budget friendly. Of course, compost is very budget friendly. The vitality and the worm tea and the castings cost just a little bit more, but they really, really are powerful. And Jack, you asked a question there. What's the difference between vitality and worm tea? Okay. We did a video on that actually with Mindy from Vermistera. So go back and watch that. We did that back in the fall, I believe. And this is basically worm castings in a bottle. It's super concentrated, super powerful. The worm tea is also good, but this just, I found, just kind of like supercharges your plants. So, but go back and watch that video for all the details on that. And there's also more info on that on their website. But grab these, like I said, the links are all in the video descriptions. Okay, so that's kind of the lowdown. Let's jump in the chat for some questions. And then I'm gonna talk about what to do. Step number one is what to do at planting time, how to feed your plants to get them off to a really good start. Okay, let's see here. What, fighting the vine borers from Melissa. How's it going, Melissa? Oh my gosh, that is such a fight sometimes. And we don't have vine borers here, but I know that you can use an insect dust on that. I know Gary at The Rusted Garden has lots of videos on that. So go over and check that out. And you also might want to give a listen to the Gardening Coast to Coast podcast. I forget what episode it was, maybe a couple episodes ago, where we covered how to deal with different types of insect sprays and dust. So definitely listen to that. Hi, Connie, how are you? Great to have you on here today. Yes, I agree with you. Simple is good, more likely to stick to a plan. So yeah, keep it simple, keep it budget friendly, and you're much more likely to stick to a routine. Okay, speaking of routine, because we do have six different things to get through today, I'm gonna jump right into what to do at planting time, okay? And this is probably, I mean, they're all important, but it's really important when you're first planting your veggies. And by the way, guys, how do you like how the new raised bed is looking here? It's just really starting to take off, just really growing. I mean, look at the scallop squash here. I love this. Hopefully you joined us on the raised bed garden series. This is, I think, the green tint Benning scallop squash from my raised bed kitchen garden seed collection. It's already starting to develop little teeny tiny flower beds. I don't know if you can see that. The watermelon behind me is really taking off and starting to grow just a little bit. Hopefully we'll reach the trellises soon. There's cucumbers back here. There's basil, there's beans. There, in the back, there's sunflowers and zinnias. And I'm loving the A-frame trellis. We've got that in a couple of spots in the garden. We did a watermelon video a few weeks ago, and here we have cucumbers and watermelon. So let me know here in the chat if you've built this raised bed, and this is all in my book as well, along with other trellises, planting plants, all kinds of fun things. Thank you so much, Debbie, I appreciate that. And before I forget, guys, today is the last day of the watermelon sale, 20% off. All of my books, seed collections, my seed book bundles, and Little Shorty, of course. A lot of people are picking up Little Shorty with that sale as well. It's a really great deal. 20% off with the code WATERMELON. Over at CaliKimGardenAndHome.com. Trinkles Garden and Home Life, thank you so much for joining me today. And thank you, your garden looks beautiful, from Irene in Georgia. Irene, great to have you. Okay, cinnamon for ants, love that, Melissa, wonderful. A lot of people are talking about dealing with ants. Okay, sorry, I'm getting backtracking here. Elena, I'll answer your question and then we'll move on to the first step. Elena says, when I buy fish fertilizer, what does it mean if it's almost solid in the bottle? Okay, this stuff is very, very thick. It's highly concentrated. So just follow the directions on the back for dilution. But usually that means you just have to shake it up a little bit. It'll kind of loosen up, but it's supposed to be very thick. Maybe it just got a little bit cold or something like that. And you know, it'll thin up and as you dilute it in your watering can. Okay, so first step at planting time, part of my routine. Your goal at planting time is really for a green leafy growth and plant health. Your tiny seedlings are small. You want them to really develop a nice green leafy growth. I want my squash leaves to be nice and green. I want them to grow lots of leaves so they have good foliage, which can support the squash and the flowers. So since you want that goal, the nutrient that you're going to be focusing on is the N or the nitrogen. So at planting time, you want to use fertilizers that are high in N, that's why I love the fish fertilizer, is because it does have a 5 in N, which is pretty good. So I concentrate on this and the good dirt plant food, but I also want my plants to be healthy. So that's why when I do my videos, I always combine a couple of water-soluble fertilizers, which is perfectly okay. In my book, I talk about a plant cocktail that I like to make. So I like to feed my plants at planting time, either with these two or with the good dirt plant food and one of the Vermistera products, the worm tea or the vitality. So you don't have to do both. You don't have to do the fish fertilizer, good dirt plant food, and vitality, because that you're going to kind of overload your plant. So just pick one of the water-soluble fertilizers. You don't need to pick both, and then follow the directions on the back, put it in your watering can, and give your plants a real soil drench. And what that basically means is you water them at the base of the plant with your plant cocktail, let it sink in, and then water again, let it sink in, because you want it to get all the way down to the roots, because the roots are what is going to help your plant take up the nutrients, take up the water, and really help your plants take off and get that good green leafy growth. So that's my quick release at planting time. But let me back up just a little bit. Before I even put my plants in the planting hole, I should have said this first, I put the slow release nutrients in the planting hole. So once I put the roots on top, they're going to take that up, and then that will feed my plants over the next few months. So quick release, slow release to my planting hole. I add my compost, my worm castings, and my organic granular fertilizer. If I've already added that to my entire garden bed, there's no need to put it in the planting hole again. But one thing that you can cut down on a little bit is if you don't have enough compost, or if you don't want to use quite as much fertilizer, you can just add it to the planting hole so that you're not going through it so much. And it just helps you kind of cut down on the budget. If your budget is tight, definitely feel free to do that. So planting time, time released, water solubles, that's pretty much what I do. And again, you guys, I know this is a lot of info today, but do yourself a favor, grab my new book, and it's all written down here for you so that you can follow along with it in the garden. It has everything that you need, my whole fertilizing schedule here, along with my favorite fertilizers that I use, so you don't have to go back and watch the video every time. This will be a lot easier for you to have for reference. Okay, so that's planting time. We're going to... Let's see, I think I got everything in here. Okay, in just a moment, we're gonna jump into what I do 1 month in. Okay, now let me just say here, there are tons of different ways you can feed your garden. I see lots of questions going by. What about bone meal? What about blood meal? What about phosphorus? What about compost tea? All those things are great, but there's 1,000 different ways you can do it. This is just my particular fertilizing routine that I've done for years that works for me. I'm sure there's lots of other great ones out there. So, just pick one that works for you. Pick one that you'll do. I think that's super important, is to stick to that routine. If you don't like to make compost tea and you don't, feel like going out every day to stir it, then don't do that. If that's easy for you to do, then by all means, pick that as your go-to method. So compost tea is great. I see Rudash ask that. I don't tend to use it a lot because it takes a lot of compost tea for me to water my garden, and that's just kind of too time consuming for me to make, and I won't do it. But it's a great idea to do that for your garden as well. I've got videos on compost tea, super easy to make. So if that's what you enjoy, then by all means, do that too. Okay, Jan, question here. Hi, how you doing, Jan? Great to see you as always. Still here, I have two zucchinis, one with a light green stem, another with a dark green stem. The female flowers do not get big, they drop off. I did fertilize, is it bugs? Often, in fact, almost all of the time, the female flowers are the ones that pop out first. So it doesn't necessarily mean you did anything wrong. They only last Well, my flowers, they're only open, I should say, for in the morning. And I believe they only last for like one day. Sometimes they do drop off, but usually several days later, the male flower will come along and you may need to hand pollinate. There's really nothing you can do, as far as I know, to bring more male flowers along. So just be patient, hang in there, and then get up early in the morning and hand pollinate your zucchini to help the bees along, or help your zucchini produce a little bit more here. Okay, let's see here. Any other questions before we move on? Wow, someone talking about quail eggs. Pretty cool if you've got quail in your garden. Okay, let's move on to point number two and the next step in my fertilizing routine. Mac, come here. He's chasing or digging or chasing something. Maybe a lizard. Okay, the next step in my fertilizing routine is, okay, we've got our planting time. Now then, 1 month in, I like to give them another little dose. So that's kind of the next step in my fertilizing routine. And this is really, you guys, for raised beds and in-ground gardens. Containers are a whole nother animal. So we'll talk about that in another live stream. But just so you know, containers need fertilizing a lot more often. I usually do mine every 10 days to 2 weeks. But for raised beds and in-ground gardens, 1 month in is where I do my next dose. And for 1 month in, the goal is really to boost your plants, to keep them growing, and get them ready for flowering and fruiting, okay? So at this point, 1 month in, your plants will have used up a lot of the nutrients that you gave them at planting time, or in your soil when you amended the soil, when you planted your plants. And they really appreciate a nice, good little boost at this point, just to kind of push them into that flowering and fruiting stage. And in this one, what I do is I give them another dose of N, or another dose of nitrogen. Now, if they have started flowering at this point, I won't give them nitrogen, but like a lot of these plants back here, they were planted, I wanna say maybe 6 weeks ago, maybe a month ago. And so I have been, I did just boost them again. I watered them with the good dirt plant food. I've been dousing them or soil drenching with the Vermistura Vitality, a quick release fertilizer. I don't give them another dose at this point of the slow release, because the slow release really will work for a couple of months. So there's no need to add additional compost, worm castings, or granular fertilizer at this point. But I do like to give them a nice good soil drench 1 month in with that high nitrogen fertilizer, and it really does work wonders. And I have seen a huge difference this year using the Vermistura Vitality. My seedlings were super green, had great roots, and just grew very quickly into seedlings I could use in the garden. They were super healthy. This also works great for struggling plants. I can't say enough about that. Several times I've had plants that I thought, I don't know if these plants are gonna make it, the seedlings, or even plants in the garden, and I give them a nice soil drench with this stuff, and it really does the trick. So highly recommend you guys keep this on hand in your garden. So first off, we've had at planting time, what do we do? And I covered that. Second off now, 1 month in. And what you might wanna do is just kind of make a note on your calendar, or maybe just like the first of every month is when you kind of do your fertilizing routine. If you need a reminder, set a reminder on your phone and just kind of make it part of your general, you know, schedule, or put it on your calendar, and that way you don't forget. And it is a good idea. I'm not so great at this, but Gary always recommends this on our podcast, is if you can keep a garden journal or write down what you used on your plants when, that's super helpful, because you can go back next month, check your notes, and then make adjustments from there. Okay. Into the chat for a couple of questions before we move on to what I do 2 months in. Okay, let's see here. Nisha just popped a link in the chat for our weekend video. It was a really fun video. I did a video on how to grow beans in such a way that you can harvest them all summer long. Beans are such an easy vegetable to grow. So if you haven't planted any yet, it's definitely not too late. I mean, they only take about 6 to 8 weeks to harvest. They like the warm temperatures. So as long as your temperatures are, you know, daytimes in the 70s on up to into the 90s, or night times, you know, 50s and 60s, you can definitely plant beans. You can plant them right in your garden beds. You can plant them in your containers. They're such a versatile plant to grow. Right in front of me here, let me show you if I can flip my camera, is a little shorty, and the beans are just exploding. exploding from little shorty. So I just checked them before the live stream. Don't quite have any teeny tiny beans on yet, but if you watched our video, you see that they're flowering. They're loving the little shorty. And by the way, guys, the little shorties are really selling fast, especially with a 20% off sale. So if you want to grow in that cute little 3-foot raised bed, it's a collaboration between Smart Pots and myself, and they're not available anywhere else, not even on the Smart Pots website. They're only available at calikimgardeninghome.com. So grab one and plant some beans, plant some greens, plant some cucumbers. They're such a fun little container to grow in. I have beans growing already from Irene. How you doing, Irene? Great to see you here. I see a question here from Rudash. Have you ever tried growing asparagus? No, I haven't. And the main reason is because it takes a couple of years to harvest for asparagus to be ready to harvest. And I just don't really have a good spot right now that I want taken up for several years. I think it would be a really fun thing to grow, but I haven't ever done it. Okay, let's see here from Hindi. How's it going, Hindi? How would you continue or combine water soluble and liquid fertilizer for container plants? How often would you use them? Any tips? Excuse me. Okay, Hindi, water soluble and liquid fertilizer are pretty much the same. Water soluble just means that it dissolves in water. So all the liquid fertilizers I use, unless it's like a ready to use fertilizer, which I don't often buy those because they're a lot more expensive, and I usually buy the concentrate, or I always do the concentrate because you can add it to water. I don't want to pay for water, I want to pay for the fertilizer. So go back and watch the container garden series. Lots of tips in the container garden series on that. But you basically do it the same way. You just put them in your watering can, and my book has all the different details about the plant cocktails that I use, and then you just water your containers with it. So it's pretty much the same, but the only difference is how often. So you want to water containers every 10 days to 2 weeks because the water drains through and they just need feeding a lot more often to help them continue to be productive. Okay, so next step. Wow, lots and lots comments flying by in the chat. Some new live stream viewers, Hoyt Robinson, thank you. Welcome, so glad that you're here, and we just have a great time here in the chat. A lot of people have been with us for years, have gotten to know each other, and provide a lot of great garden support. Okay, so 2 months in, so we've got planting time 1 month in, 2 months in is what I call my mid-season boost. Now, the goal for 2 months in is to encourage flowering and fruiting. So remember how I said the N, or the nitrogen, encourages green leafy growth. At 2 months in with a mid-season boost, you do not want to give a fertilizer that is high in nitrogen, because we don't want to encourage more green leafy growth. We want to encourage flowering and fruiting. So a good thing to do with that is you can give a fertilizer that's a little bit higher in the P and the K. So, you know, what I pretty much do at this point though, is I don't really worry about getting another liquid fertilizer. I pretty much just go with the Vermistera Vitality or the Vermistera Worm Tea at this point. That's enough for my plants to really just, you know, give them that nice little boost and feed them. What you could do is at this point, give them a little handful of compost. That would definitely be helpful. Or look for a fertilizer that has a higher number in the middle, which again is the phosphorus, which encourages flowering and fruiting. So I don't really have a favorite fertilizer I use for that. But if you want to do that, you can definitely look for that at your garden center. There's lots of things out there that would be helpful for that. Or just give them the worm tea and the vitality just to keep them really healthy and to encourage that flowering and fruiting. So again, you want to do a nice little soil drench, really make sure that that fertilizer and that feeding gets down to the roots where the plants need it the most. Let's see here if I had anything else that I wanted to talk about here. I guess that's about it. So yeah, the only thing at this point, if you're growing things like leafy greens, like I have right back behind me here, and herbs, plants that are grown for their leaves, at this point you definitely can go ahead and give them a high nitrogen fertilizer because you're growing them for the leaves. They're not going to flower and fruit. I mean, they will eventually flower, but at this point you definitely want to encourage more leaf production. So you're probably harvesting from your little salad in containers. I love this one here. It's got endive and tatsoi, which are in my specialty green seed collection. And I'm really surprised at how well they're holding up to the heat. We haven't had tons of heat, but we've definitely had some temperatures in the 90s a couple of days. And they're doing just great. These I don't even think I've shaded. So I really feel like it's because the plants are healthy. I give them, the Vermistera Vitality, every couple of weeks, and they've been producing and doing very well. So leafy greens, kales, chards, and herbs, things that you grow for the leaves, 2 months in, you can definitely give them one of the higher nitrogen fertilizers. Okay, Terry, good question here. I saw that scroll by. How often should you add worm castings to containers? For my containers, again, different animal, I do add a little handful of compost or worm castings or both about once a month. And I do the same for my hanging basket. So the smaller the container, but for containers and more enclosed spaces like that, again, about once a month there for the slow release and about every 10 days to 2 weeks for the quick release. And you're gonna see a huge, huge difference in your plants and your container plants when you fertilize them more often. So definitely a big, big deal for that. Now I do have more info on container gardening too in my first book, Organic Gardening for Everyone, including fertilizing and planting and that type of thing. So, and how to water containers. So definitely grab this book as a resource for containers as well, and watch our container garden series. Tons and tons of tips in there. Okay, so we've got a planting time, 2 months in, 3 months in, 4 months in. You're probably at this point harvesting your vegetables, maybe pruning them, maybe disease is coming in to take over some of your plants. I know about 4 months in is maybe around August for some of us, and some of our plants are kind of lagging a little bit. And I like to call this my end of season boost. Really the goal for this is to get new growth and possibly a second round of vegetables out of your plants. So at this point, because you've probably already harvested a lot from them, you want to give them, and pruned, you want to give them another boost of that high nitrogen fertilizer. It's quick release and slow release. So this is a good time, end of season boost. I've got a video on this. You can just look end of season boost up on my YouTube channel. Is I pretty much do the same thing I do at planting time. Give them that slow release, compost, organic granular fertilizer, and worm castings. And what you can do at this point, you can't put it in the planting hole, but you can kind of put it around, it's called side dressing. You can kind of put it around the base of your plants. I actually did a little side dressing of compost on my beans in the bean video from Saturday. So if you want to know how to do a little side dressing, go back and watch that video. You kind of just scratch it into the base and then water it in with your quick release or your water soluble fertilizers. So pretty much your plant cocktails, your Vermistera Vitality or worm tea, your higher nitrogen fish fertilizer or good dirt plant food, make your plant cocktail and water that compost and the slow release fertilizers down into the soil. Drench the soil, let it sink in, drench it again, give it a nice deep drink so the water gets all the way down to the roots. So good time to do that end of season boost. And the cool thing is, now Sheila's saying 4 months in is time to start cleaning up the garden. If you have a short growing season, that could be August, September for some of you. You may be getting cold weather then, and it might be time to start cleaning up the garden. Maybe you're getting your frost in September. So you wouldn't maybe necessarily want to do that at that point, but you want to plan ahead for fall. So that's a good time to get your fall vegetables in. And then we're talking way ahead of this because we're just barely getting to summer. But when you have your, if you have a frost in September or October, back up about 8 weeks and start getting your fall vegetables in. And we'll have more on the fall garden series, coming up later in the summer, but something to think about. But if you're a southern gardener like me, we can grow all winter. So a lot of times if I give my end of season boost, or I do give my end of season boost in August, September, it'll be enough. We still have warm weather. It'll be enough to really jump that plant back into production. And I'll get a whole nother round of vegetables because we can have hot weather into November or even December here. So just so you know, that's how that works. Keep an eye on your weather and then kind of plan accordingly, according to that. Now it's always good to plant a new fresh wave of veggies. That's my late summer garden series I usually do, and the late summer garden seed collection is great for that. Quick growing veggies you can plant mid-season for a late season garden to give yourself a fresh new wave. Okay, so let's see, that's the 4 months in end of season boost. And wow, I thought I had one more, but I guess that's it. So it's pretty much a monthly fertilizing schedule. Planting time, 1 month in, 2 months in, 3 months in, and 4 months in. So if you missed any of that, go back and watch the replay. Again, I know it's a ton of information here, and that's why I need a copy of my new book here, because it has everything written down for you. You can grab it with a signed copy, you guys, signed and personalized for 20% off. Today's the last day with the code watermelon. And for those of you that have ordered my seed collections, thanks so much for supporting our seed shop. We're a small family-owned business. We do everything here in-house. Everything is sent out from our home here. And we have a small team that works with us here to send out your seed collections. There's always something special in there. We always consider include a freebie of some kind. A free seed packet goes in every single order, as well as some kind of little freebie as well. So you never know what you're going to get when you order from our seed and garden shop. And there's tons of things there. We've got 30 seed collections, 2 books, which always come signed and personalized, as well as the 5-gallon Cali Kims, the 10-gallon, which is over there somewhere with a tomato plant in. I don't know where that one went. And the little 1 gallons, as well as a little shorty. So grab one and grow along with me. It's really a ton of fun. Okay, let's see here. Eva's Life Stories. Thank you so much for subscribing to our channel. I appreciate that. Tons of garden tips. The blackberries are doing great. Actually, I just gave them a kind of beginning of the season boost before they started to flower, before they started to really leaf out, and they're going crazy right now. Tons of flowers, tons of berries that aren't ripe yet, but we'll hopefully be able to show you that on our next garden tour. Okay, let's see here. Some more questions here in the chat. Montana Bean Blossom, great to see you here. Have you ever planted corn, and how much nitrogen does corn need? I actually have only planted corn one time, but I was very generously gifted some corn seeds, Hawaiian sweet corn, from Jan. I don't know if she's still here. And I gotta get those planted because Hawaiian sweet corn just sounds amazing to me. And as far as how much nitrogen corn needs, that's a good question. I don't know. So if anyone knows that, pop that here in the chat. I would probably just do my normal fertilizing schedule. I don't really go by how much nitrogen a plant needs. I just kind of do my general thing. And the plants really seem to enjoy the regular feedings. Okay, Cheryl says, I've temporarily relocated here in SoCali. Welcome back. My patio is 90% shade. Is anything edible or just pretty that will grow in the shade? Yes, there are. It's good. You can grow greens, kale, chard, lots of different herbs grow in the shade. You can actually, there's a planting plan in here, I believe, for partial shade, if I recall. I'm not sure if I can recall that or not. But anyway, there's 10 planting plans in here. But I would definitely grow smaller varieties, because smaller varieties such as cherry tomatoes, rather than big, huge varieties of tomatoes, won't take as much sunlight to ripen. So I would give that a try. But definitely your greens and more compact varieties. So the container garden seed collection will probably be a really good one for you to start with. You might not get as much production in partial shade or partial sun, depending on which way you look at it, but you will still get some. Herbs you could grow is actually basil. It does really well in partial shade. Sometimes it gets a little bit too hot in the full-on sun, and smaller varieties of cucumbers. So give those a try, and hopefully you'll be able to get something growing. And just make sure that you come back and share with me how things go. Okay, let's see here. Hindi, can you record a garden tour video, please? We have lots of garden tour videos. We just did one, I think, the beginning of May, maybe just a few weeks ago, and we'll do another one in June. So we have tons of garden tour videos. We pretty much do one almost every single month, except during the winter time when there's not quite as much going on. So do make sure and go back, and we have a whole playlist on garden tours. Robin, great to have you on here. First time catching you live. Welcome. So glad that you're here, and I hope you can join us again. We're not live streaming next Monday, but we do live stream most Mondays at noon Pacific time. Okay, Terry, what vegetables would be best in hot afternoon sun in a raised bed? Well, right behind me here, this is hot afternoon sun. This is in hot afternoon sun. Right now I have umbrella over me, so it's shaded. But go back and watch the kitchen garden videos And it's all in here too, is my raised bed kitchen garden plan. These all do well in hot sun. We've got tomatoes, we've got watermelon, which loves the heat, peppers, which love the heat, the squash, some basil back here, which is actually being shaded by the squash leaves, partial sun, kind of filtered sun, which does really well. And we've got cucumbers. So lots of things will do well in hot sun. If it gets over 95-ish degrees, I'll throw a piece of shade cloth over this because no vegetables really like to be that hot. It causes the blossoms to dry up, drop off. So you do want to keep shade cloth handy if you live in super hot temperatures. And thank you so much, Nisha. You know what? I actually forgot to plant okra this year. I'll probably pop some in here. Okra loves the heat, doesn't need shaded, and does very, very well in heat. And I've got okra in one of my seed collections, I think my spring garden. So it grows very easily from seed. You can direct seed it right in your garden beds. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous plant. I'm not super fond of how it tastes, but I love how it looks. And the variety in my spring collection is red, I believe it's called red burgundy okra, and it's absolutely beautiful. So Nisha, thanks for that reminder, I appreciate that. Okay, let's see here. What else do we have in the chat here? Basil. Amsel basil from Proven Winners. Okay, great. Always good to have good recommendations for varieties that do well in different areas. And let's see here what else we have in the chat. Any other questions before we move on? Oh, by the way, before I forget, stay tuned to this Wednesday for a video coming out. We did a really fun harvest last night. Something we've been wanting to harvest for a long time, and there's a little hint over on our Instagram. Last night, we posted a little video over on Instagram, a little behind the scenes. But tune in on Wednesday. That video will be out. And this coming weekend, I'm going to be doing a video on how to grow tomatoes in containers. So make sure you stay tuned for that. It'll be a special Memorial Day edition. So tune in. There's lots of fun content coming up. And there's lots of content coming up in the summer. We'll be doing some harvesting. We've got eggplants going. Yes, I saw what someone said, plant some eggplants. They love the heat as well. I forgot to mention that. Have several varieties of eggplants going in the garden, and they do very well in the heat. We've got some black beauties, some long thin purple, and I think there's one more kind of striped purple variety I have, and I forgot the name of it, but eggplant are one of my very favorite things to eat. In the summertime. Okay, let's see if there's maybe one more question I can answer here before we tune out. Melissa, see you later. Have a great time at your class, wherever you're growing. I don't see any more questions today. So guys, thanks so much for hanging out with us. Again, we're not live streaming next Monday. If you show up, we're not going to be here, but we'll be back in 2 weeks. In the meantime, got tons of content for you. And don't forget the sale today. Last day ends at midnight Pacific time. 20% off everything site-wide with the code WATERMELON. Grab your seed collections, your smart pots, signed copies of my books, and we'll see you again in 2 weeks. All right, guys, have a great week.